Yo, this is Chris Cast with Chris Abraham, Season 3, Episode 9, Episode 9, Episode, I don't know, 9? Season 3, Episode 9, if I didn't say that the first time, 9, auf Deutsch, and this episode is about two things, which I probably should have made it into two episodes, but I won't, because they are interrelated. All right. TLDR, yo. Sorry for my stuffy nose today. I'm allergic. The allergy is being allergy. Is manifesting in a honk, 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 honk. So if I wanted to speak French, I would have good French because my nose is blocked. All right. First of all, on the TLDR, all my labs came back great. I ran into a friend who hasn't seen me a while, and he sees weight loss. I am going back to the cafe instead of just working at home, which is really fun. And I wrote a brand new article for Substack about my OMAD / really failed state, completely floppy, dirty, not 100% successful intermittent fasting that has been working, though, and has been showing up in my lab work, showing up in my weight loss, showing up in body inflammation and feeling better in general. And I will share that with you in more detail. And then in the show notes, I will include the link and as much of the article that I can fit into the description area that this article, that anchor.fm allows me to use. All right, I'll be right back.
In French, that's bienvenue dans l'épisode 9 de la saison 3 de Chris K avec Chris Abraham.
In German, you would say
willkommen zurück zu Chris Cast Staffel 3, Folge 9 von Chris Cast mit Chris Abraham.
In Spanish, that's
bienvenido de nuevo al episodio 9 de la temporada 3 de Chris Cash con Chris Abraham.
In Portuguese, that's
bem-vindo de volta ao elenco de Chris. Meu nome é Chris Abraham. Esta é a temporada 3, episódio 9.
In Russian, you would say
«Добро пожаловать обратно к Крису, актерский состав, 3 сезон, 9 серия, меня зовут Крис Абрахам».
Welcome back, welcome back, welcome back. This is Chris Abraham, Chris Cast, Season 3, Episode 9. First of all, let me read you what my delightful doctor wrote to me via the app called My Chart or whatever. This is from Peter Vasquez, MD, Peter A. Vasquez. Vasquez, M.D., November 26 at 3:51 p.m. Mr. Abraham, the good news is that you do not have diabetes. What you ate that morning may have affected the glucose levels, but this is why we do the hemoglobin A1C. The A1C is a 3-month average of your blood sugar and gives us a much more accurate picture of your blood sugar control. This number has improved and is now in the normal range. This is excellent news. Continuing to work on weight loss, limiting carbs, and increasing activity will be key to having this continue in the right direction. Please call with any questions. That is good news. Welcome back. This is Chris Cass, Season 3, Episode 9. I'm going to tell you about how my superego constantly needs to deal with my very, very, very heavy-handed, strong-willed, defiant id, so as to manifest weight loss and health on a very spineless ego. And it's basically the topic of my last Substack, which I gave to my favorite editor out of Pakistan, and he will be doing a revision of it, so it's even better, and he'll break it into two parts, because I think that it was sort of ranty. So I'd love to see how well he does. He charged $30, and I think it's $30 well spent to have better content. What do you think? Anyway, so TLDR, too long didn't read, is I always try to do a one meal a day. I eat that within 15 minutes to half an hour. I try to limit my calories to about 1,500 calories a day. I try to make it high protein, high fat, low carb. I try to keep my carb below 5 grams or 5%, whatever. I oftentimes do not do that. For example, today I made a roast in my slow cooker and it was only 800 calories. So I'm going to have a second meal at noon. So my first one was at 7:30 this morning. Yes, I know it's weird to have just roast, but I did. And at noon, I'm going to have more roast. And it's going to be about 1,600 calories. And then I'm going to cut off for the day. This afternoon, I'm going to the back to Giant to get tons and tons of greens and spinach and all that other kind of stuff. So I can make sure that my meals aren't just big hunks of red meat. Oh, trigger warning for vegans. Sorry. They had an amazing deal at my local Giant. I might even pick up more of these steaks because they were basically half price. And they go in the freezer fine, I think. J'espère ça. We'll see as I defrost them. Anyway, so what I do is I have a tool called Zero, Z-E-R-O, and it is a Kevin Rose-produced app for iPhone and Android that lets you track rather sophisticatedly your intermittent fasting. I always go for like 36 hours, 32 hours. I aim at one meal a day with about a 15 to 30-minute eating window. But like I said, today is going to be a 24 or a 19-5, which means 5-hour eating window. And it'll actually be closer to a 19-5. But If I blow that and I have something late in the afternoon, which I don't anticipate, I will back off again to possibly an 18-6 or a 16-8 or a circadian rhythm if I even need to, which is 12-12. But I will not go any further than that. I will not, but I always aspire to longer fasts. And I also aspire to 1,500 calories. But I always am willing to allow myself to back down from that. It's almost like going for an ultra marathon of 100 miles, but being happy with 50 miles, or being happy with 100K, being happy with 50 miles, being happy with 50K, then being happy with a marathon, then being happy with a half marathon, then being happy with a 10K, then being happy with the 5K, and then just being happy that I got a run in it all, right? So it's another analogy I have is that my very fit friend told me that one should always break, not break, one should always enter the gym every day, whether or not you go ahead and do a full workout. So you need to get into the habit of going to the gym. Let's say you go to the gym and just turn around and walk out, or you go to the gym and just spend half an hour on the treadmill, or you go to the gym and just do some stretching, or if you just go to the gym and get a smoothie, or go to the gym and just pick up some protein, or buy a towel, or buy a t-shirt, or whatever. But every day, go into the habit of going to the gym. Even if it's just to use the hot tub, or the steam room, or the pool, or the shower, or whatnot. And with a goal every day of doing your full whatever leg day, or your full hit day, or your full whatever powerlifting day, and then you will get into the habit even at lower performance, and you will improve from there. I'm actually finding that I had been suffering from lower back pain for upwards of a month, to the point where I was not performing on my rower, on my stationary bike, or on my treadmill desk. So when I got back to them, I quickly found myself running out of steam. And I just allowed that. I would barely get, you know, 15 minutes in, even easy on the stationary bike. And then yesterday, I, you know, 35 minutes passed, and I didn't even realize it on the stationary bike. Over the weekend, and I'm going to go back to my treadmill desk, but over the weekend, I did upwards of 6 or 7 miles on it over the course of the day. So be very gentle with yourself, right? It's not easy to fast. It's not easy to work out. It's not easy to change lifestyle. It's not easy to change diet. So shoot high, aim high, but give yourself a break if you you can completely fail. What I think people make the mistake of doing is they have this, oh, fuck it mentality, which is if you make even one mistake, it enables you the ability to reset till tomorrow. No, don't reset till tomorrow. Consider it to be a battle royale with cheese. If you go to battle in the battlefield, let's look at World War I. If you go to battle in the battlefield, it's not binary. You go to war, you storm the front, and it's not either you take the hill or you, you know, raise the white flag. It's not either or. It's not binary. You might not win the hill, but you hold your ground, or you lose, seed half your ground, seed a quarter of your ground, C-E-D-E, seed a little bit of the land, but you take whatever land you can or hold your ground. you don't retreat. Retreat is not the only option if you do not meet your goals. Even worse than retreat, it's not, what is it called? It's raising the white flag is, I give up. Surrender. So, surrender is the word. Comme on dit en anglais, surrender. So, never surrender. Sorry about that. So don't do it. It's not either you perfectly do your macros, perfectly do. It's like veganism or alcoholism or overeating or whatever. Like, I've given up drinking. I don't think I had a problem. I think for health reasons. I think my friends thought I had a problem. I think gluttony is my problem, not alcoholism. I talk about this in the article. So I hadn't had anything to drink since March 11th, 2020. And then 2 weeks ago, my lovely friend Mira and I went to a place called Swingers, which is an indoor golf club. And I thought I had terrible breath for whatever reason. I was really obsessed with the fact that I had appalling breath that was like rotting corpses. I don't think it was true. Nobody mentioned it, but I felt the deep need that I wanted to have some straight whiskey so I could sort of use it in I know it's crazy, but use it in place of a gargle. So I ended up having two neat Jamesons that night. And then the very next night, I went out to Friendsgiving, and I had a rum punch, and I had a glass of Pinot Noir. And I haven't had anything to drink since. So what I didn't do is come with this all-or-nothing mentality, which oftentimes people who are addicted and who have gone clean and sober feel like if they fall off the wagon once, then all of their sobriety is undone. The truth is that the entire time they were sober, their body was healing, their mind was healing, their heart, literally their heart was healing, their relationships with their families was healing, pressure was taken off of their nervous system, their liver, their kidneys, their stomach, their heart, their circulatory system, everything. That time without drinking chronically every day was a real respite to the body. In the same way that intermittent fasting, no matter how much or how little, is a respite for the body. It allows it to recover and heal. In much the same way that my favorite YouTube vlogger, tuber named Seth James Damore, always talks about how important after every race cycle that he does in terms of his mountain running or his marathon running, he takes 2 weeks of not running at all to allow his body to recover fully. Because if you constantly push stress on the body without giving it plenty of time to recover, then the body, instead of becoming stronger, starts to break down. So I think it's important to be really generous if you decide to take up intermittent fasting or decide to take up ketosis in a keto diet. Popping out of ketosis is fine. It happens. You can just go back into it. It's not, you don't surrender, you don't retreat. You can retreat a little bit. Let me take that back. You can retreat, but never surrender. Oh, I forgot what song that is. looking for, you can never surrender. So, you can do it. Start it. Don't say fuck it, I'm going to eat everything and I'll start again tomorrow. Because that's the cycle of destruction, where it's always mañana, 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 tomorrow, 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 tomorrow. The sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. Just thinking about tomorrow. So you need to kind of understand that tomorrow, mañana, 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 tomorrow never comes. That's the irony of that, is to go back to my Catholic upbringing, it's extremely essential to not wait until the hereafter to find your heaven. It's important to try your best to find your heaven on earth. Even Jesus told us that. Even Buddha told us that. Life is suffering, but in those suffering, in that suffering, you will find joy. And I recommend lowering your standards, because joy is much more accessible when you are grateful for the shitty life that you already have. I'm sorry. I'm terrible motivational speaker. I am not your role model. I am not a role model. Like I said, okay, so one more thing. There's a couple more things I'm going to share in just a second. Come back. Don't give up on me. I do not have a fear of rejection, and I do not have a fear of being left. I do not have abandonment issues, so that's not the thing. But I'd love to hear you and have you back after this break.
Oh, thank you.
All right, there's this thing called dirty fasting. There's this thing called dirty keto. There's this thing called dirty, 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 dirty dog. Dog kitchen. Dog kitchen. You the dog kitchen. So I stock several things to make... Sorry, there's an airplane going by. Or a helicopter. Can you identify what air vehicle that is based on only the noise? Do 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 kind of keto-ish. Well, let's just go non-dirty fast. A non-dirty fast, a clean fast, says that all you get to drink during the fasting period is water, black coffee, or black tea. Any type of they don't allow diet drinks, they don't allow... in fact, I believe it's keto too, right? Ketosis, you can get knocked out of ketosis by drinking things that have sugars or that have carbs or that. So no Cokes, no sweet teas, no cream and sugar in your tea or coffee, no heavy cream, no nothing. But there are some dirty ways of doing it. Of fasting, right? My dirty fasting includes the following. I'll drink lots and lots of bone broth when I get, first of all, in order to avoid, hey Google, what is the ketosis flu?
On the website health.harvard.edu, they say, the so-called keto flu is a group of symptoms that may appear 2 to 7 days after starting a ketogenic diet.
Hey Google, what are the symptoms of keto flu?
On the website health.harvard.edu, they say, the so-called keto flu is a group of symptoms that may appear 2 to 7 days after starting a ketogenic diet. headache, foggy brain, fatigue, irritability, nausea, difficulty sleeping, and constipation are just some of the symptoms of this condition, which is not recognized by medicine.
So, here is what I find, and my cardiologist agreed. He actually recommended this product. But what I do is most of the time you're suffering from those things, you just haven't had enough water. But water is not enough. You need to have your electrolytes. And electrolytes, to some people, is a pinch full of Himalayan pink salt or whatever. But to me, my cardiologist recommended a brand called LMNT, like the letters LMNT, which is pronounced element, from Elemental Labs, and it's called Recharge Electrolyte Drink Mix. I got the ones that are raw, unflavored, which, honestly, I'll tell you, makes your water taste like fish aftertaste, like ocean fish aftertaste, or a little bit like ocean water in your mouth. Like, it's very noticeable. So if you don't like that, they actually have some flavors that I don't think are that much trouble. But in this one, and it's expensive, and they come in packets, but there's no sugar, no gluten, no dodgy ingredients, paleo keto friendly and vegan friendly. And there's 1,000 milligrams of sodium per packet, 200 milligrams of potassium, and 16 milligrams of magnesium. Now that is a full, if you will, a full electrolyte combo. Brondo, is that right? Brondo is from Idiocracy. But this is for real. So I get through the struggles of a one meal a day, or even 32 hours or 36 hours or 48 hours. Whenever I get peckish at all, I will drink water, yes, but I'll also pound some beef bone broth or some chicken bone broth, or I will make sure that I drink water with Element in it. And it makes everything better, right? Drink plenty of water, but also make sure that you get your electrolytes. I will include a link, a sponsored affiliate link to Element on Amazon for you if you're interested, and if I remember. And that's it. That's my secret. That's what makes it dirty, is the bone broth. And I don't think the elements makes it dirty, but the fact that I will guzzle bone broth, I'll even guzzle regular broth. Like if I'm really struggling and I don't have any bone broth in the house, I will go down to the convenience store and get like literally chicken broth. No noodles or anything in it, just the kind of stock. Chicken stock or beef stock, the kind of stock that you put into, you know, your cooking. If you're going to use a stock pot or whatever and you need broth or stock in your recipe, I will sip on that or guzzle that or drink that. I do think that has plenty of salt. It has plenty of protein in it, and it might actually break keto, but I'm not that interested in keto. My goal is calorie restriction. My goal is not eating all the time. And my goal is not being a glutton. So I will not drink broth if it keeps me from eating food. So everything is done desperately, in desperate measures by my superego to keep my id on a leash, because my ego's worthless and it's garbage. I'm heavy-handed, but superego id. Yeah. On that note, all the contact info will be next, and I thank you for being here. Thank you for being my friend. Welcome back. My name's Chris Abraham. This here is Chris Cast, Season 3, Episode 9. Episode 9er. My name is Chris Abraham. I am at chrisabraham.com. I am at twitter.com/chrisabraham, instagram.com/chrisabraham, chris-abraham.com on Tumblr, chrisabraham.com/blog, chrisa.substack.com for Substack. I am +1 202 352 5051 for phone calls, for texts, for Signal, for WhatsApp, for Telegram. I am, I don't know. I guess all the rest doesn't matter except the fact that I'm anchor.fm/Chris Abraham for this podcast. But wherever you listen to me, please subscribe, like, thumbs up, give me 5 stars, if you will, or give me any stars, and write a review on either Apple Podcasts or on your app or on your web thing or wherever. I could really use the boost. And I am much obliged. I will talk to you soon. Have a great day. And if you celebrate it, happy Hanukkah to you. Ciao.
Yay!